discovered for the movies, and how were you signed up at MGM?
I was discovered singing in a place called The Little Truck by a man named Roger Edens, whom I didn't know, but who went to MGM and said there was an interesting, I suppose he said that, girl singing at The Little Truck. And I was not impressed because I didn't want to be in California. I didn't want to be, I hadn't thought about the movies. And so the next day, they called and said, would I come in? And I said, I can't come right now. I have to get my father. And so I went with my father, who came in from Pittsburgh on the airplane, and we sort of laughingly went to the studios, never dreaming, in fact, fighting terribly against it, my father was, never dreaming about the movies. And so they took me into audition for Arthur Freed. And there I ran into Vincent Minnelli, whom I'd met in New York. And he said, oh, you've got to stay here. And it took me to Mr. Mayer, and I auditioned, and I left that afternoon and told Billy Strayhorn, my friend, I do not want to be in the movies. I left a job I loved in New York at Cafe Society, and I don't want to be an African, or that I am an African, but I'm really half American. An Afro-American, I didn't like some of the roles that most Afro-Americans played in the movies at that time. So I thought nothing of it. And lo and behold, they took me.
What were their plans for you?
I have no idea. I don't think that they had thought much about it, except they were having quite a bit of trouble with the unions, because organizations like the NAACP and Urban League were trying to fight the union so they could get some black people into them. And I was useful, really. So as I tried to get out, I got pressure from those organizations to show me that it was important that I stay and be in the movies. And I was very unhappy at this club that they heard me, and I came home for the first Christmas out there, and Count Basie also told me he'd spank me real hard if I didn't go back. You know, it was kind of tough and lonely being the first one. Actually, Eddie Rochester Anderson was the only great star on the contract at that time. And me and the Shoeshine Boy were the only friends out there for a while.
What kind of treatment did you get from the people, not the other stars necessarily, but people like the makeup people and the hairdressers?
Well, I didn't. I was separate, and Sidney Gilroff was wonderful to me. He was head of the hair department. And when they didn't like to work with me, he said, I'll do Miss Horne, which he did for the rest of the time I was there. We became friends, and I didn't mind the other.
He told us that story, too, when we interviewed him.
Did he? Yeah.
What do you think, did Louis B. Mayer, do you think he thought it through, how am I going to use this lady?
I don't think so at first. But you see, I was also useful in that I would work in their cabarets that friends of theirs owned in Chicago and Cleveland and various places. So when they didn't have anything for me to sing in the movie, I could go and work in their nightclub. So I was useful.
And how were you used in those first those early MGM musicals that you did?
I just sang a song. Mm.
Leaned against a pillar.
Yeah, being very glamorous, supposedly.
What what image did they try to project from you? The publicity department went into high gear with each new star. How did they deal with you?
Actually, he's a nice man that used to be the head of the department, the publicity. He knew that they said I was an MGM star when I went to work in the cabarets, and I didn't get in a lot of trouble actually there, because I wasn't a part of anything very much. There was one incident in New York when I was working at their Capitol Theater here. I went to an opening of another performer, and they took advantage of some pictures that were made by the cabaret photographer. And there was one of the pictures accidentally was posed very badly, or it looked like something else, and they began to be the early trashy headline things with Lena Horne, who had just come into New York, and this, that, and the other. And I called Strickland, Howard Strickland at MGM, told him what had happened, and they sat on it. It was stopped. So I did have one experience with them.
Yeah, they tended to be very protective of their
Yes,
people,
of course.
What was your first film role? Do you remember?
Panama Hattie, I sang a song in. And that's at the time they said the Spanish girl was great, you know, and so I had to quickly get that finished.
Did MGM consciously want you to be promoted as a Spanish girl?
Well, I had auditioned here in New York to work in a cabaret, and the owner said, if you would only pass for Spanish, we could hire you. But we're not going to take, you know, any black people. So it wasn't unusual to have MGM react that way. I think they thought it would be easier. But the couple of girls that had before me passed for strange people were quickly put out. There was no protection for them. But I never had that problem.
You always knew exactly who you were.
Exactly.
Of course, in Cabin in the Sky, you finally did get a chance to show what
that's
you could
do. Why Vincent and I stayed friends. And he had wanted to do Cabin very badly. And he was there a year before I came in. And he said, I'm going to get to do it now. I know. So finally, they put the film Cabin. That's the only thing I ever did there that I liked and felt, you know, that I wasn't embarrassing.
Well, there's a freedom to your acting in that.
Yeah, yes.
How did Minnelli kind of, did he build a protection or some sort of, to give you that freedom to be?
Well, oddly enough, with all the flack about unions and so forth, the people working there, the crew liked me, and they were protective of me. And he and I were New Yorkers, and we had that kind of empathy to draw upon. And he just told me that I should just act like a young chick, you know, young girl, and play it. And it would annoy anyone more forceful in character and aggressive than I was, you know. I think it was a good trick.
You were wonderful. Did you become friends with some of the other people in the Freed unit, like Roger Edens and Kay Thompson?
Yes, yes. If it weren't for the musicians and the people concerned with music, I would have been more miserable than I was, because that was my milieu, and I had those people as friends. But we never thought about the movies when we were together.
It also seems nobody thought about color either. It was about music.
No, well, they were New Yorkers and music and artists. And even the ones that weren't from New York were artists. And I don't think artists have that hang up.
Talking about Cabin in the Sky, it certainly was an unusual film for those days. Was it successful?
Yes. not as successful as Stormy, because Stormy went overseas and all the trenches in England, the English soldiers, the French soldiers, everybody knew me when I went overseas in 47 from Stormy Weather. And Cabin came along later, I think. Anyway, it was successful. But many things happened, the war, you know, and I was trying to remember the name of the Liberty ship that I christened while I was at MGM in 43, I guess, or 43. It was named for a black, and it was a black captained Liberty ship. And that was a very exciting thing, and Howard Strickland arranged that for me. And I did a lot of Army shows. And,
I hope that's in your daughter's book.
Well, it's old hat.
Speaking of Stormy Weather, I think one of the most moving parts of the show that you did, your live show that you did back in the 70s, is when you sing Stormy Weather as you sang it back in the 40s, and then after all you've lived as you sang it in the 70s. Could you describe that?
I describe it by telling you that it was first heard by me when I was 15 and a half. My mother took me through some friends to the corner where black people sat at the Cotton Club in New York just before I went to work there. And Ethel Waters was the star of the show. And she sang Stormy Weather. And that's the first time I heard it. And it thrilled everybody in the audience. And I never dreamed I'd be singing the song, so I went through years of not bothering about it. Well, I went through a couple of years and went over to Fox to make Stormy Weather. And they said, you're going to have to sing it. And I said, I can't. And I had a bad time with the director, who thought that most of us could sing that way. And Cab Calloway finally got me in the corner and said a few horrible things to me, good things, made me angry, and I sang it as best I could in the movie. But as years have gone by, I heard Sophie Tucker tell me, don't you ever finish a performance without singing Stormy Weather. She said, because people will begin to associate the song with you, and you will always give them, whether you do it well or not, you will give them something they associate with you. That's a good trick of show business. And I was married, I had problems, I was raising children, I was traveling. I met and was happy with people, I was unhappy with people. I was angry at newspapers, I was angry with certain things happening in my lifetime, and I learned to sing it. I learned what it was about, you know, and I also learned to overcome all those things that made me sing the song. So it was a mixture of being grown up and knowing that under every sheet of paper there's a little bug sitting.
And it's absolutely electrifying when you sing it after all that. It really is an outstanding piece of theater, actually.
Yes, it's good theater.
Tell me about what happened to your musical numbers in the films. How the films, the numbers you did in MGM films, how they were designed and what happened when those films played in the South.
Well, they were very easy to crop out, my scenes, because I usually didn't stand very close. There was very close to the next performer in the scene, and I never had any conversation except in one movie when they did a little segment like of Showboat. I think it was The Life of the Authors, and Catherine Grayson and I exchanged. She was playing Maggie and I was supposed to be Julie, and otherwise I didn't have any contact with anybody in any of the other movies.
So
except with Rochester, and he and I had things, scenes together. So when they went south in the states that didn't like it, they could easily lift the scene. And otherwise, they had me very you know, glamorous and dressed beautifully and orchestration's beautiful and lighting beautiful and everything gorgeous, and then they'd cut it out if they didn't need it.
Yeah, there's that wonderful number in
the Honeysuckle Rose, yes. Benny Carter made the arrangement, and Vincent directed that too. It was the first time he finally directed somebody on screen. It was me in A Thousand's Cheer, and I did a segment in another movie with the Nicholas Brothers, and he directed that.
And now you talked about the Jerome Kern, that was when the clouds rolled by.
Yeah, I guess.
When you did the sequence from Showboat, was that considered sort of an audition for the film version?
I probably thought it did. In fact, I hoped it was. But another incident came along that showed me that it wasn't. So I got over feeling disappointment, and I had made friends with Ava, who did Showboat. We were good friends, Ava Gardner. So that's one of the things that helped me sing Stormy Weather.
You tell, again, from your show, I remember the whole sequence of talking about how they developed the makeup for you and how Ava ended up using it. Can you tell that story?
Well, they auditioned lots of makeup on me, and they had me stand next to Eddie Anderson, someone as they thought all of us looked alike, and they kept adding makeup for me to match them, and it didn't work because, well, I just disappeared, you know. So they finally decided that they would create a new makeup for me. And so they created this makeup called Light Egyptian and auditioned, and that was it. But meanwhile, Ava used it. Hedy Lamarr wore it when she played Tondaleo, and a lot of people. So I was happy with it. I used it on stage for years.
The other story you tell in talking about your friendship with Ava is how that she would come by
at my house. Yes, we lived near each other, and Ava would stop by every afternoon because we liked an afternoon martini, evening martini, and she'd get there around 6 on her way home, and my husband made wonderful martinis, and he would give her hers and give me mine, and she'd say, "I'm so tired of hearing you speak even and sing," she says, "because you know what they do. They shut me in this little soundproof booth, and they make me sing to your records that you did when you thought you'd make Showboat." And she said so that I would look like I knew what I was doing. And it must have been a bore for her to have to listen to me every day and move her lips, practicing to be in sync. And actually, she had a sweet little voice, you know. So we'd drink the martinis, and she'd bitch about it, and I'd agree.
What kind of roles did you refuse to do?
I wasn't offered any I refused to do, except one and here in New York on the stage, a play that they owned called St. Louis, what was it called? St. Louis Woman. And they wanted me desperately to do the part that another girl did. But I got flack from organizations and my own people. Actually, I didn't really like it. The music was glorious. But when I refused, I got finished for a while, and they put me on layoff, you know, didn't get paid, and didn't let me go and work in cabaret for quite a long time. But that's their prerogative. That was their prerogative.
Didn't you, though, when you went to MGM, say, "I will not do servants"?
Well, my father told him I wouldn't, told Mr. Mayer that he didn't want his daughter playing servants. There's nothing wrong with being a servant, but they were servants who probably didn't understand the recipes they had been given to cook. I didn't want to be in a jungle being, but my father told him that. And he said, I can hire a maid for my daughter for her own, and I don't want her being a native of another country on the screen. So I think Mr. Mayer was taken aback by this, and so they were left with me and didn't know what to do with me, actually. And they gave me lots of songs to sing.
Obviously, the role in Showboat, Julie, was one of the roles that got away. Were there others that you would have liked to have played that you think you would have been right for?
Well, I think that I would have been right for the Tonda Leo part. Not that I wanted to do that particularly. I'd love to have done it. I'd love to have been a wicked cook, even, in a rich, white, antebellum family who poisoned them all. I'd have loved that, but they didn't have those kind of maids in the movies at that time. Like, you know, slip something in the goulash, or, no, that's Hungarian, slip something in the peas and rice.
Nowadays, of course, that would be politically incorrect.
Oh, it'd be great, but it'd be great.
Stormy Weather and Cabin in the Sky, were there any other roles that really gave you a chance to act?
No. By then, I was when I was taken, put back on payroll, I had gone through many months, a couple of years of trouble, a year, and Joan Crawford told me, she stopped one day. She spoke to everyone. She was a movie star. Joan Crawford said, look, I've been through this with this studio, and she said, you've got to fight. And she said, go to MCA and ask them to fight for you. Now, I was already paying 20% to one agency, and I wasn't making that much money, and I said, how am I going to pay MCA? They said, they'll work out. I was in debt to them for a few years, not in debt, but paying them off. And they made a couple of calls, evidently, and they were all buddies out there, and they said, you know, let the poor broad go and work in cabaret or wherever. And so they told me, all right, I was forgiven.
Is there anything in your film career that you are proud of?
Only Cabin. And actually, I was one of the weakest ones in Stormy Weather. Everybody in it was so talented, and they were so happy to be doing the picture. And, you know, maybe now, maybe now. And when I made Cabin, I said, maybe now, maybe now. I waited 10 years, and Sidney came along. Every 10 years has been a Sidney Poitier, that is.
Talking about Sidney Poitier, what was... do you think the significance of his success for black actors?
I can go right up to this year and say, what is Denzel going to do for us? But it's very unfair for one person to have this burden, because other things in life are so difficult. And to have to represent all of a people is a tough road to hoe. And it's not called upon from white people, you know. So I don't know. I hope that Denzel will make it easier for a new young black guy. A lot of great young ones working on the soap operas. I think it's marvelous. It should keep on going.
You talked about, tell me about your husband and what he was doing at MGM and how you got together.
Well, he was a musician, not a musician, he was a conductor out there when I came. I didn't know him. And he had been an orchestra leader here in New York with the Hit Parade Orchestra. and he had an orchestra of his own, and then he went to MGM when Bing Crosby went out there to make Temptation. And they were friends.
We're talking about how you got together with your husband, and if you would mention his name, because I don't think we did.
Yes. I thought he was very arrogant, and I knew that he had once had a big orchestra, and his name was Lenny Hayton, but I didn't want to be around him, and I gather that he felt the same way, because when he went to see me sing at the cabaret, he told someone before he went, "She can't be that good." And then he went to see me. And I don't hear what I don't know what he said about that, but suddenly, one day in the commissary, where I was allowed to eat with Vincent Minnelli and the writers on the movies, he came in and he looked at me and I looked at him, and you know that coup de grace happened, that happens sometimes with people across a crowded commissary, and the next thing I knew, I looked up on the set we were making with Hazel Scott. I was making a wonderful song that Kay Thompson arranged about Joshua at the Battle of Jericho. And I don't know whether you've ever seen that, but I had a gorgeous dress that Irene made for me, and beautiful costumes. It was a great scene, and Lenny was standing over with Kay in the corner. And that night he came to where we were recording, and Kay said, "You know, if Lenny was doing this, we'd have been finished in 2 hours. We were 5 hours struggling to do it with another conductor." And we got to be friends that evening. We went over to, I went with Hazel Scott and Kay Thompson and a few other people to this little joint that let me come in, and Francis, something it was called. And he came in, and there was a little piano play, and he played piano for hours, and I sang, you know, and that was it. And it was very good for me, because he was a fine arranger and conductor. And when we knew that we were going to like each other, it began to be uncomfortable. And in fact, we were married for 3 years before it was announced or before anybody knew. And because Tex McCrary, who's a publicist here in New York, had done a survey when I was on my way after announcing it. And there was tremendous hate mail from both white and black people. Some musicians, many musicians are, they don't see color in the way that the ordinary society does. And he didn't realize that I am colored or black or whatever, and like it. And when he began to understand that, he grew more and more wonderful to me. And that was good for my ego, to have someone really care and like both sides of me. I loved him very much, and he helped me a great deal.
Were you blacklisted?
Hmm.
I never knew that.
Along with some marvelous people, Mrs. Roosevelt, Gene Kelly was for a while, and I belonged to the Hollywood Independent Citizens Committee first, and then, of course, it never occurred to me that my loving Paul Robeson as I did, and he becoming a great friend to me, my grandmother had helped him get a scholarship to Rutgers before I was a little girl, you know, and I admired him, and I never realized that I'd get to meet him at that first year I went to Hollywood. And he knew about my people, my grandmother, my their history. He told me, he was one of my first mentors about being as I am, because many of our people didn't discuss it with their offsprings, because they had so much other on their mind, they couldn't sit down and give a geography lesson every time. And he told me so much about my intimate, my personal family beside my black family. And because I was friends with him, and America was, well, the State Department was already very angry with him, so that I was called a communist. And I wasn't, of course, but it didn't change my thinking, but I was glad I knew him, too. So I was blacklisted and red-channeled. That was the one the unions put out. And there was here in New York, Ed Sullivan and important people had their list, too. So that all helped me sing Stormy Weather.
Do you have a favorite musical number from your 40s and jam career?
No, actually, I was busy trying to learn how to sing. When I found that was going to be what I had to do, I tried to learn more and more music and tried to establish a kind of style. And my association with Billy Strayhorn, who was my closest friend, and through him to Duke Ellington, I began to learn how to be a singer. And so that was in my mind, not movies, not improving in the movies, because I knew that was a dead end. So I had to hone up my other talents and get out of that trap, good trap.
But when you see any of those numbers now, do you say, oh, I sang that one well, like, for example?
No, the only thing I sang well I liked was when Lenny made Who Knows Where or When for me, and he made Love that I sang in Follies. I forgot Follies. I liked that little bit of scene I did, also with Vincent Minnelli. And I don't know what I did after that. But the few that Lenny made for me, I liked doing. But I sang, when I first started. Even now, I think, I want to be Aretha Franklin. What the hell, you know?
There's a song in The Wiz, which has become something of an anthem for you, and that's another thrilling moment on your stage show.
Yeah.
Tell me about that song and what it means to you when you sing that song.
Well, when I went to see The Wiz 5 times in a row, I said, oh, God, isn't this a wonderful show? And I didn't listen to that last song very, if you believe, very much. I loved everybody in it, and it was so, the energy was so marvelous, and it was so good, and people went and to it. And I didn't know that Sidney Lumet, who's my ex-son-in-law, was going to direct the picture. And my 2 grandchildren, who were little at the time, said to me, you gotta do this part so you'll have something to leave for posterity. Nothing I'd ever done before meant anything, you know, to them. And so I said, well, I'll try and to find something in it that I like. And they made a wonderful arrangement. And my manager at the present, whose name's Sherman Sneed, took the CD, of the tape of it, and we went back to Santa Barbara where I lived, and every day he drilled me to sing with the song without the words, and I sang and sang to this tape and all. I've had to believe that I could go and sing in the cabaret every night, or I'd have to believe that I could walk onto a stage and say a few words to people. I think artists are always nervous and don't believe in themselves. So I began to use that. And so when I came back to New York and I saw the set and I saw these beautiful brown babies floating in the air, and I knew some of the guys in the crew, you know, and I tried not to be nervous, and the makeup man was wonderful to me, someone that had worked with me once before. And so when I got out there in the scene, I was feeling okay. And I sang it, and it began to work. And it came off pretty good. So afterward, when I was getting ready to go back on the road, before I thought that I might be doing my own show, I said, I think I'll keep this song in the act. It's a good finisher, you know? And I did, and it became great for the ending of my show, Lena Horne, Lead Lady in a Music or whatever. And the thing is that as 5 more years went by and I missed something happening, I'd say, the song isn't working out. It isn't true, if you believe. But if I let that go, I'm not going to make it, you know? So I've had to hold on to it. I don't sing it much anymore, but it has a lot in it. And the guy that wrote it, Charlie Smalls, who wrote The Wiz, was a great talent, crazy and destructive of him, for himself. But he wrote a great song there. It's like Stormy Weather, in a way, if you believe.
Great, thank you. Finally, I want to talk about your comeback film, Death of a Gunfighter.
Oh, yeah. I was working. I lived in New York on West End Avenue, and I hadn't thought about the movies. And Richard Widmark called somebody and said, how do I get in touch with Lena Horne? And I want to send her a script. And he sent the script to me, and I said, oh, maybe after all these years. But at that time, I didn't have any aching desire about it. But I said, I don't have a gig this month. I'll go and see what's going to happen. So he came to New York after a few weeks, and I had worked with a acting coach, John Lenn, I think his name was. And he helped me a great deal. And so Richard came one afternoon and said, I want to read the script with you, which we did. Mind you, I guess this happens to everybody, but I didn't know about what they do for movies. Anyway, he sat on the sofa and I sat there and we read the lines to each other. He said, well, you listen, you know, which meant a great deal to me. And you're reacting like someone who's thinking about what I'm saying to them. So I went out there, and I was bemused by the whole studio out there because they were beginning to have the attraction for tourists and everything. And but Richard is a sensitive man, I think. He had been friends with Sidney for a long time. I didn't need to know all that, but I knew because I felt it from him. He didn't frighten me, and he a couple of things I said he reacted to in the correct way, not that I test everybody, but we got along very well, and I was terrified of the director because he was marvelous and fast and used to actors, not amateurs, but it worked. And at that time, they had already killed John Kennedy. And I had a tough time hearing gunfire or a balloon bursting near me or anything like that. And Carol O'Connor was on that picture. And he said to me once, what do you think about a show that really is terrible and reactionary about everybody? I said, well, it's familiar. So I think, we talked like that, and it was good. I never really saw the movie except on TV a few years later, and I wasn't that great, but it was intelligent, you know. But I was treated well, and I've never forgotten Richard for that.
Now, you were good.
I was?
Yeah.
Oh, well, you know, we're not good judges of ourselves. Please believe me.